Harper Audio Australia presents The Escapades of Tribulation Johnson, or A Woman Writes Back, by Karen Brooks. Read by Felicity Jurd. This book is dedicated to my amazing, kind, patient, and generous sister, Jennifer Farrell. Throughout the hardest and saddest year for our family, she continually showed the depth of her compassion, love, and fortitude. She is the best of women, the best of people, the best of siblings. I am so very blessed you are mine, Jenny. Explanatory note. Throughout this period, Mrs. or Mrs. were terms of address applied to women who, regardless of their marital status, warranted the social distinction of not being called mistress, a title which carried rather unsavoury connotations. Hence, Tribulation Johnson, despite not being married, is called Mrs. or Mrs. Johnson. Other single, widowed, and married women in the novel are also accorded the title Mrs. Prologue. An honest man, being troubled with a scold, told her, if she continued so bold, that he would have a case made out of hand to keep her tongue in under his command. Anatomy of a Woman's Tongue. The pot-shotten woman, tangled in the sheets beside me, looked and smelled like a corpse. Paler than the moon which, against nature, still sat in the heavens, and colder than Papa's stare, she lay unmoving, mouth gaping, arms and legs akimbo. It wasn't until I nudged her a few times and she emitted a foul-smelling groan that I saw with no small measure of relief she was alive. I knew where the blame would have fallen had she indeed gone to meet her maker. I squinched out of the bed, scratching and wriggling in my night shift, which was now inhabited by the fleas that called the mattress home. The innkeeper had sworn this was his best room. Easy to declare, even honestly, when standards were so low. Before I washed, I checked my travelling companion once more, pressing my fingers to her scrawny neck. A pulse knocked the tips. What was I supposed to do? We'd a tilt boat to meet. My mind chirped and wheeled, much like the swallows outside, who rose in a mighty flock to greet the dawn. First breaking through the ice coating the washbasin, I quickly dragged the frigid cloth over my face and under my armpits, rinsing my mouth and rubbing my teeth for good measure. God save me! The words rasped like a blacksmith's chisel. I swung around and faced the relic stirring in the bed. Abstinence Gumble. A widow and distant cousin of the Bishop of Canterbury, she'd been paid to accompany me to London. With her chicken coop hair, bleary eyes, and shaking hands, she wouldn't have been able to accompany a hymn, let alone a person. Why, when a person has been cursed with a Puritan name, did others assume the appellation defined them? The only thing Mrs. Gumble had abstained from as she drank the thirsty sailors under the table last night was any modicum of self-control. Then again, I was called Tribulation, and, for some reason, trouble always followed me. Or as Papa repeated ad nauseam, I caused it. If you ask me, and no one ever did, it was really a matter of perspective rather than truth. Though if I hadn't said what I did when I did, I wouldn't be banished from Chartham and here, at the Gull's Cry in Gravesend, en route to London to live with a relation I'd never met. With, let's not forget, a tap-shackled beldam in tow.
Oh, my head,
wailed the tap-unshackled beldam, fingers pressed to her temples. One eye cracked open.
Please, please, child, Mrs. Gumble pouted. Fetch me a posset, a tincture of herbs from an apothecary, anything to stop the raging storm in my skull, quell the churning ocean in my stomach.
With a whimper and a ripe toot from her rear end, she pulled herself into a sitting position and looked about, smacking her withered lips together. Here, I said, with less sympathy than I should. Drink this. I poured the remnants of wine from a jug into her goblet. With wide, blood-crazed eyes and a canny smile, she gulped it down.
Good girl, she said, wiping her mouth on the sheets. If you could procure some more, I'll be right in a few hours. The innkeep will oblige.
She began to ease herself back under the covers. But Mrs. Gumble? I went to the window and pushed it open. The air was redolent with fresh frost, fish, barnacles, and bilge water. We don't have a few hours. The boat will depart with the tide. I pointed at the river and said craft. Already the docks were busy. Men from the East India Company crawled over the rigging of anchored ships, and on the smaller wharves, fishing boats were mooring while the tilt boat to London was being prepared for passengers. Whistles, shouts, and even a song cleaved the air, giving the day an urgency my ailing chaperone clearly did not feel. I summoned an authoritarian voice. "We must make haste, Mrs. Gumble!" I flung the cloth back in the water and began to rummage through my burlap. What I'd done today was important. I needed to make a good impression. Mrs. Gumble waved a careless hand.
"Haste? Why, I can barely move!"
She adjusted the pillows and gazed about, blinking.
"It's not so bad here. I'm sure your cousin won't mind if we're a day or two late."
She began to yawn. It turned into a belt she didn't even try to disguise.
"Nor your father, for that matter, I mean," she said, slapping her chest a few times to loosen whatever adhered to the inside,
then dragging the covers up to her chin like an invalid.
"He hardly needs no."
She winked, as if we were conspirators.
"Let's remain here."
I stopped midway through pulling out a gown. "Here? A day or two?" She nodded amiably and shut her eyes. I wanted to shake her. Mrs. Gumble had seemed so respectable yesterday when we left Canterbury, all smiles and prayers and, "Yes, Reverend Johnson, no, Reverend Johnson," as Papa gave her instructions on where to go once we reached the city and listed his expectations regarding my behaviour. She was especially humble when he gave her coin to cover our expenses, but the moment the coach left the city walls and we were no longer observed, she produced a small leather flask and tipped the contents into her mouth. I continued to stare at this woman who was supposed to deliver me safely to my cousin's door in Bridewell. When I was forced to leave Chartham, the village in which I'd spent my entire life, my sister Bethan pointed out I should be pleased. I was always threatening to go. But, as I said to her, it wasn't the leave-taking causing me distress as much as the manner of it. Nevertheless, Bethan was right. I'd always dreamed of leaving our small village and seeing London and many more places besides. Maybe the stories I relished had given me ideas that had no place in my head, or any woman's for that matter, according to Papa. But it was also because I'd always felt there had to be more to life than simply listening. For that's what women did. From the moment we entered the world, we were compelled to keep our lips sealed and ears primed so our fathers, brothers, other men, God, could pour their wisdom into them. So they could tell us what to read and eat, when to retire, to bed and attend church, when to speak, and most of all, when and whom to marry. All the while, we had to smile and nod, regardless of our opinion on the matter. "Yes, sir. No, sir. As you wish, sir." Through it all, we had to be agreeable, lest we upset some unspoken law or rule, or worse, offend the men. Bethan might have been content to abide by the directives that bound us, obey the constant instructions, but I was not. It required a docility and silence I simply couldn't endure, nor even pretend to. Papa always said I was unnatural, that I'd too much to say for myself. He said a great many other things besides, all of which included the prefix un. Ungrateful, ungodly, unguarded, unlike other girls. I oft wondered, especially as I grew older and seemed to forever land in scrapes, if a part of me was broken. The part that would enable me to be more like Bethan and the other village girls, accept what God and our fathers willed. When Papa first decided I must leave, he hadn't known where to send me. The Bishop of Canterbury had even been consulted. Could I be a teacher for young ladies, a governess, companion to one of our titled cousins, anything that didn't involve me remaining in Chartham? Every suggestion left my blood frostier than a winter morn. Christmas had been a miserable affair, made worse by the fact that I knew the negotiations for Bethan's nuptials were stalled. The business of removing me took on fresher urgency. Then, a bolt from the blue. Bethan announced she'd heard from a relation. Though they were once close, time had created a distance between them that magically was suddenly bridged. A solution presented itself. I was to board with this lady. Letters went to and fro, and finally, arrangements were in place. During this interminable season, I seriously contemplated running away, becoming one of those missing people advertised in the news sheets all the time, rather than wait for others to decide my fate. What changed my mind was Bethan. A few weeks before I was due to leave, my biddable sister came to my room and sat on the bed. 33 years of age, which made her 16 years older than me, and having suffered the loss of our many siblings in between, Bethan was so sensible, so obliging. It was as if every negative attribute a female could possess had been distilled into me to abnegate her cooperation. That's what I overheard Papa saying one day. I was earwigging, again. She was also ridiculously lovely, with thick chestnut hair and large brown eyes. No wonder Sir Marmaduke had proposed, until he retracted his offer, having, in his mind, found a better alternative. Surprised at Bethan's temerity, had not Papa forbidden anyone to talk to me? I determined not to mention her suitor. She began our conversation like so many others between us, with a long sigh. Oh, tribulation! How often have I warned you to hold that uncouth tongue of yours? The question was, I assumed, rhetorical. My sister, her back straighter than a schoolmaster's cane, hands in her lap, bestowed her usual look of sad remonstrance. And still, you never learn. But I do. I just refuse to accept the lesson. Life is not a series of escapades, tribulation, she said impatiently, quoting Papa, but a matter to be taken seriously. Nevertheless, you've been given an opportunity. What you choose to do from here on is entirely up to you. If it was up to me, I wouldn't be travelling to London to become a companion to some old woman and her widowed daughter. I was unable to keep the derision out of my voice. Shush, you little fool, snapped Bethan. It was most uncharacteristic of her, even when dealing with me. I never thought it a mistake to surrender you to Lady Adeline's influence. Alas, she put injurious ideas in your head that you allow an unhealthy encouragement. I swallowed the sadness thoughts of Lady Adeline always conjured. After our mother died, followed closely by Bethan's husband, my sister, who up until then was unknown to me as she married when I was but a babe, was forced to return to Chartham. This was mainly so she could take up my care, but over the years, I heard tattle. Bethan's marriage had been conducted in such unseemly haste, it was only once she became Mrs. Pratt that she discovered her sweet-faced carpenter husband, Joseph, preferred fists to embraces. Not only that, his death left Bethan in such debt, she'd no choice but to return, Papa grudgingly paying her creditors so she could put the past behind her. I vaguely remember her homecoming. Excited to think I'd have a sibling to bother, especially an older one who could answer the many questions forever spinning in my mind, I was disappointed when she first spent a great deal of time holed up with Papa in his study, and then, when free, was so quiet and unassuming. I began to wonder if we were even related. Able to affect the role Mama once held by managing the household, when it came to me, she remained remote, barely offering a word. She treated me as if I were a vase she feared to break or an exotic pet to be studied. She'd ordered the maids to dress my hair, prepare food, ensure I learned my letters and repeated the catechism. Together we would attend church and occasionally the market, but we were rarely alone. It wasn't until she'd been back a few years that she started to come to my room when I was abed and spend time reading with me. I loved those moments. Perhaps feeling sorry for Bethan and the manner of her return to Chartham, or maybe it was that she had to return at all, Lady Adeline invited her to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.